presentation by Communications Director Bridget Harvey on the strategic communication plan for the town of Webster. So I'll hand the time to Bridget.
Thank you. So earlier this year, I talked to you about two of the major efforts of the communications department as we get things rolling in this new department of the town. And the strategic communications plan is one of those. So I know Kim distributed the plan itself to you as well as this presentation. So I'd just love to take you through some of those highlights and allow you to ask any questions you may have about this. And as always, I'm also open to answering questions offline as well. So we'll start off with what a strategic communications plan is and why it's important for the town to have one. So our plan is an internal document that's really going to establish the priorities and the purpose of the communications department as it's being newly created. So it's those parameters that this department will hopefully operate on as it continues to develop through the years. It's also a document to guide our communication and public relations efforts in relation to our target audiences. So establishing what those target audiences are and how we can best reach those through the different channels and opportunities that we have. It also organizes our efforts and looks to create efficiency and effectiveness in sharing our information and news, and provides intention and sustainability. So it makes everything really have purpose that we're doing rather than just doing whatever we wanna do and throwing and seeing what sticks. And it is also to foster accessibility while we are reaching our audiences. So some of the key components you'll see as you review the plan are identifying those purposes and priorities of the department itself. It's identifying our target audiences. It is setting up guidelines for our external and internal communications, identifying what our response to conflict should look like in an ideal situation, and guiding our media contact and public relations efforts through earned media opportunities. So who are our target audiences? Who are we looking to reach? Who are we currently reaching? So that's going to be our Webster residents, but on the flip side of that, it's potential residents who may be looking for a new place to live. It's our town employees, but it's also prospective town employees that we are looking to recruit. It's business owners and prospective business owners where we want to market our community as a really great place to come and show them that we're economically friendly and open to this growth. It's our local media, it's developers, contractors, and realtors. So some of the highlights you'll see throughout this is establishing key messaging and supporting facts. So what that means is establishing messaging points that are based on the needs of our community and it's supported by our town actions. So supporting economic growth is a good example of a messaging point, and how we would support that is saying that we're working with businesses to create an environment that is open for them to flourish here. It's tailoring our approach to our audiences and to the messages being sent. So we all know we have the opportunity to use social media, to use our website, to use print media, but it's really using those to deliver information to our target audiences and really making sure we're getting the best return on investment for the vehicles that we're using. And it's encouraging internal collaboration and knowledge sharing. So that's where we're really looking at our internal communications, which will encourage not only knowledge transfer inside of our organization, but it also bolsters our communications efforts outside of the outside of our organization as we're looking to reach our community. We're looking to centralize our communications efforts. And what that really does is it breeds trustworthiness as we have consistency across the board. People know things are coming from the town. We have our consistent answers to questions as we approach the community. And then one of the things that's most important to me is making sure our constituent experiences are really data-driven. So we need to be regularly evaluating our success and failures and being honest with ourselves of what's working and what's reaching people and what's not, and looking to grow from there. So just some early accomplishments of our department, and you'll see some of this within the plan, and some of it is, lives outside of there. But this plan itself is something that we set to accomplish within this year, and we've done so. So we've done that using research and feedback and staff collaboration. So throughout this process, I've invited staff to several input sessions to garner their experiences and ask what their recommendations on where we should go and what feedback they have for how we can communicate with people. And that was very valuable in putting this plan together. And I was very impressed at how many folks within the town staff participated in that. And to do this, we also drafted our plan to outline our effective communications for audiences using research from other organizations' experiences, as well as what lives within our own organization. You'll also see that we have our updated model for town meeting AV. So we have fully implemented our user-friendly and portable system, which is quite a bit more cost-effective than what we've used in the past, and really is, I believe, the future of where meetings like this will go. But another important thing to highlight there is that we are cross-training a number of town staff members. So you'll see, not to put her on the spot, that Maria is here with me today. She has stepped up to be a cross-trained employee of the town. And what that really does is it provides for us to not have any gaps in case somebody is not available to come in, and we can continue to use the same model and not be halted with a less than favorable situation for some amount of time. I know that many of you received our new monthly e-newsletter. In our first month of having it out, our subscribership's already gone up 13.8%. We are, I believe, 1,100 folks subscribed to that. We have a 69.1% open rate, which is compared to a 42% industry average within local government. And we have a 10.2% click rate and engagement rate on that email platform, which is compared to a 4% industry average. So really quite a bit above the government industry. And we've also implemented our social media plan, which has seen an 89% increase in reach, a 72% increase in average impressions, and a 247% increase in average interactions on our posts. So looking to the future, what's next? Website updates. You'll see that in the plan. But I've been working with our departments to simplify and to address some of the concerns that residents have had and other users have had about our website to make it more user-friendly and a more practical tool for everyone. As I mentioned earlier this year and earlier this evening, establishing a style guide which will breed consistency and make our branding look similar across the board, and will really solidify our methods. Expanding our community outreach and looking for opportunities to engage with nonprofits, with businesses, and with our residents in a more robust way than we have been doing, and really make the organization immersive in the community. Establishing a crisis communications plan to react to crisis situations, to protect the reputation of the town and really make sure that we're making smart and measured decisions in the event of a crisis or an emergency situation. And all of this will lead to much improved constituent relations across the board. So I know there's a lot there and even more within the plan, but if there are any initial questions, I'm happy to answer them.
I think this is great. My question is, you said there's 1,100 subscribers. Mm-hmm. And do you have a goal for how many subscribers you want by the end of the year?
2,000.
And how will this information be used? I just want to make sure we're dispelling some of the myths of how this data might be used.
Are you talking about like a constituent relationship manager?
Yeah.
Like a contact manager?
I'm talking about how people's email addresses are going to be used.
Oh, they'll be used to contact them about information from the town.
Very specific to the town.
Yes.
And I want to be, I just want to clarify that this won't be used for campaigns.
Absolutely not.
This is not a campaign database, and I just want to make sure that.
Well, can I speak to that?
Yes.
Okay. Charlie, do you remember when I became supervisor 4+ years ago and Steve Peace, our IT director, Karen Bach, who ran cable at the time, pseudo communications, and yourself, I said, you know, Kim Doyle and myself, you know, we want to build this database of email addresses. We get contacted by our citizens all the time. They submit for planning boards, zoning boards. They call in for tree evaluations that are falling in, you know, places and all this. We got all these people reaching out to us, but we're not garnering these email addresses where we could potentially utilize them to communicate to them things such as, hey, we're going to be doing chip seal on your road, in the next month or whatever. And the big concern was, and of course I was new, so they're like, this guy, he's probably crazy, whatever. I said, oh my goodness, you know, there's going to be some privacy issues there, and there's going to be whatever. And I said, you know, I got to tell you something, guys, and I appreciate that. I said, you know, as you get to know me, I'm a measure twice, cut once person. We're going to make sure that this thing has policies and procedures that are locked down. And the last thing I would ever want something like this used for, and I'm going to call it nefarious, because if somebody is sitting in this seat and uses that database of 10,000 or 15,000 email addresses of our citizens as the incumbent for campaigning, that's evil. So the best thing we can do is put procedures and parameters around it to make sure that it never happens. Do you recall this conversation, Charlie?
Not in so much detail.
Oh, I do. I do. All right? Because now 4+ years later, and I'm very, very, you know, Peggy, Catholic guilt, Bishop Kearney, you will wait, you know what I mean? I feel very strongly about this, the compass of right, so to speak. But the reason why we got to lock that down with procedures and policies in the future, I can assure you, you don't have to worry about me doing it, not on my watch. I'm not going to be supervisor forever. And I'm going to leave the next supervisor with 15, 20,000 email addresses. That's a powerful tool if put in the hands of the wrong person.
Well, I think it's important to also call out, as every one of us has run a campaign or managed a campaign, is the data that we use for those campaigns comes from completely different sources.
As well it should.
And yes, as well it should.
Yes.
That's why I wanted to call that out. It's very important. People should feel comfortable providing this information because they're a resident of the town. They want to communicate, get information from the town. And I just wanted to make sure that there was clear lines of there's a lot of great information here, and it's a good way to communicate events that the events go on the website, so it's more of I guess that would be a pull versus a push. You kind of have to know to look for the event as opposed to pushing out, hey, there's all these events that are happening in the community, which would be a great way to use.
Mm-hmm. Absolutely.
Well, we're still, and I mean, now I'll step off my soapbox of the nefarious way to use it, and I think I know what source, Jennifer, that you're reading. I think it's a source that is probably not representative of the 45,000 citizens' feelings in the community, but I could be wrong.
Maybe not, but I think it's important to call that out.
I think you're making a very valid point, and it's nice to, you know, to get that information out there.
Well, it's, as long as there's information in the source of that, I will say this, is that, it's not a question, Bridget, but because some the news source of what Councilwoman Wright brought up, also from that source was that this monthly newsletter that was launched on August 1st, you can call it myths or dispel rumors or however you put it, it had, if I remember correctly, Bridget, more hits, opens, and clicks to links in the first 3 days after it was launched than the weekly newsletter its predecessor had in May of 2023 for the aggregate 4 weeks of that newsletter.
So I actually have those numbers for you.
Please put them out there because...
In August of 2023, the weekly newsletter, which was 4 newsletters, had 126 total views compared to 1,198 views on our August monthly newsletter one weekend. And then in August 2023, our weekly newsletter, so that's the 4 newsletters, had a 14.3% open rate compared to our 69.1% open rate on the new monthly newsletter. And then in August 2023, our newsletter had a click rate of 1.8% versus the current click rate of 10.1%.
So I want to go to the last page that's up on the screen right now, because it all spawns off of that. Is that I'm an old guy, so I'm not really, I don't practice this stuff. I'm not on TikTok and Instagram and all that stuff, but I got enough kids that, you know, it's oozed into me how it works. So when you get an 89% reach in your social media lately, and 72% increase in average impressions, and 247% increase in average interactions, to me, if our previous reach out through whatever the posts were, and the content of the post is completely a different thing, okay? That's different. But if the post that the government is putting out is tantamount to a tree falling in the woods because nobody hears it, because nobody sees it, well, that's a worthless thing. So one of the things that I've been very happy that Bridget came in with her base of expertise and said, this is how we can increase actually people actually looking at our stuff. And job one, as we communicate with the citizens is, will they look at our stuff? And I give the example all the time that when I own my business, I think that one of the biggest mistakes that was made by our marketing and merchandising department when we did direct mail campaigns, and you spend a lot of money on direct mail campaigns, is they spend 95% of their time on how the letter inside the envelope looked. What does it say? How does it look? This and that. And they spend 5% of the time on the envelope. Not understanding that human beings spend 0.1 second when they get the mail looking at that envelope before they throw it out or they decide they're going to open it. And that's what the devil in the details of communications is something that I am really happy that we are starting to pay attention to. It's going to pay major dividends to this town. I've said it unapologetically that the one thing I hope when I'm kicked out of this job or if I get to leave on my own reconnaissance, it's important to me that the community feels that the brand of the town government of Webster is good. Because the reality is, the people that I work with, these are good-intentioned people. And I'll be the first to admit that it bothers me when things are thrown at the town government. We're an easy mark. Come on, blame it on the government. The government's got to be the problem, right? And sometimes they're very right. Well, I've asked our staff, here's what we can do. Let's do what we say and say what we do. If we can continually do that at every department, then citizens who are rational people are going to see that and experience that, and they'll start to think well of their town government. And it would be good to have them think well of the town government, genuinely feel well of the town government, because then when they hear something that, hey, did you hear that there's going to be a Costco in town? Boy, that government is they're not transparent and they're slimy and this and that. You'd like to think and say, well, you know, geez, my experience with the town government has been that they're pretty upfront, pretty transparent, and pretty whatever. That's the goal. That's the goal of a business. That's a goal that should be in your personal life. I don't know about how you raised your kids, but one of the first things you say is, do as you say as you do. And rational people that you experience in your job and your life, they'll notice that, and they will gravitate toward it. We need to do that here within our internal communications and our external communications. I will get off my pontification soapbox.
I'm pretty high on it too.
Thank you.
I just want to reassure people that we're not mining their personal information from wherever we can find it and adding it to our database. And along those lines, Bridget, maybe, you know, people are watching and they haven't subscribed to it yet, but they'd like to. How do they do that?
They can do it in a number of ways. They can go to the communications page of the town's website, and there's an inline sign up form there. We'll also be posting it regularly on our social media pages with a link to a sign up sheet, or they can contact me directly through my email address or office number.
And both of those are found on the town website. Great, thank you.
Bridget, do you have a disclaimer, you know, that we only use their email, you know, for a specific?
So, they have to subscribe to our e-newsletter. So a number of people were imported after they had subscribed to the weekly newsletter and those were transferred over. And then another caveat to that is there has to be an unsubscribe button, and if they opt to unsubscribe, we can't resubscribe them from there.
Yeah, we've experienced a lot of, I say a lot of unsubscribe, and we've used the database of emails we have.
Yeah.
To send out the chip seals that need to be done, and at the bottom the disclaimer is if you want to unsubscribe, and some people
certainly, and I mean that happens for a number of reasons. People move, it's no longer of interest to them, and that's something we totally respect. It no longer works for them, and that's fine.
Bridget, can I ask to this, and I probably should know the answer. You gave a nice summary, five slides here. You also gave the town board a draft of a 25-page strategic communication.
Mm-hmm.
This is a draft, so this hasn't been presented out to the community yet, is that correct?
Correct.
Okay. All right. Do you have an idea of when we would get to the point where the community would see the full 26-page?
I would say if there are no major concerns from the board, we would move forward with this being effective, though I don't think it requires a vote or anything. It will just be posted to the town's
right.
website.
Right. Okay. I've already taken a lot of boxes when I was preaching. I made some notes when you were going through this. I think it was on the 5th. Strategic target audiences, the Webster business owners, and the prospective business owners. I know that you have already had a couple of meetings with Barry Howard at the Chamber of Commerce.
That's correct.
Okay. Included in that effort. The next page, where you have, I'm just trying to think here. I put a note that, and I think I mentioned this last week, that we have an IT automation task force that has been formed. We were supposed to have our next meeting this week, but boy, several people had some issues that we had to reschedule to next week. But that is really going to be focused on how do we improve internal communication. And this happens in every organization. I mean, anybody watching this live or watching it on the tape, think about your own company you work for. And, oh, geez, you know, I didn't know down the hall in accounting they're doing this, or we're down this hall in sales. It would have been nice to know that. Departments tend to sometimes in organizations be siloed, and when they're siloed, unfortunately, I think you look back after 2, 4, 6 months and say it would have been nice if they were on the same page on something. They could have done, you know, saved some money for the work. So we've been addressing that in the last couple of years. I think we've made good headway on it. And then in the external communication, and what automation can help with that, you know, Denise, I know that when we were vetting town clerk candidates and tax receivers, one of the things that came up is that we need to be realistic that if 10, let's say it's 5,000 people come into town hall in a typical year for services, to pay their school taxes, town and county taxes, to get dog licenses, in all the services that the town does. Realistically, in 10 years, the people that come into town hall will not, they will not accept that as an option for them. Because they're grown up and they'll be in their 30s and 40s and have young kids and they're like, I'm not taking time out of my day between 8:30 and 4:30 to go in for a service that should be on my phone, should be on. And so we're, that's part of this committee, is that we need to start thinking like that. How do we get to that point? We love seeing people at town hall. We're not trying to chase them out, but you have to have that option for those services. So, you know, I'm really interested to get going on that task force. So that's all I got on that.
Are there any other questions I can answer this evening?
No, I want to thank you on all the things that you've already done in the left-hand column of this page. And when I look at it, you've been very busy.
I have been busy, but I love doing this work.
Well, we're grateful to you.
Thank you.
Thank you.